from a good and gracious King. I will give to you my burden as you give to me your strength. Come and fill me with your spirit as I sing to you this praise. You deserve the greater glory, and so
have mercy on me, O God, because of your unfailing love. Because of your great compassion, blot out the stains of my sins. Wash me clean from my guilt. Purify me from my sin. For I recognize my rebellion. It haunts me day and night. Against you and you alone have I sinned. I have done what is evil in your sight. You will be proven right in what you say, and your judgment against me is just. For I was a sinner, yes, from the moment my mother conceived me. But you desire honesty from the womb, teaching me wisdom even there. Purify me from my sins, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Oh, give me back my joy again. You have broken me, now let me rejoice. Don't keep looking at my sin. Remove the stain of my guilt. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a loyal spirit within me. Do not banish me from your presence, and don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and make me willing to obey you. Then I will teach your ways to rebels, and they will return to you. Forgive me for shedding blood, O God, who saves. Then I will joyfully sing of your forgiveness. Unseal my lips, O Lord, that my mouth may praise you. You do not desire a sacrifice, or I would offer one. You do not want a burnt offering. The sacrifice you desire is a broken spirit. You will not reject a broken and repentant heart, O Lord. Look with favor on Zion and help her. Rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. Then you will be pleased with sacrifices offered in the right spirit, with burnt offerings and whole burnt offerings. Then bulls will again be sacrificed on your altar.
Good morning to our Wainfleet BIC family. It's really hard to tell because of all the COVID haircuts, but we are the Travers from Wellingport, and we'd like to welcome you to today's service. We miss all of your smiling faces and hope to see you again soon.
That was a great welcome from the Travers. I welcome you today too. It's so good to be together. Even though we navigate these uncertain and frustrating times, let's remember together today that the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. And there's not a place where his mercy and grace won't find us again. Having just celebrated Easter, let's also remember together that we live on this side of the resurrection, where there's always hope.
Amazing grace.
So let us come boldly to the throne of our gracious God. There we will receive his mercy and we will find grace to help us when we need it most. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 16.
What a great time of worship this morning, and man, what a beautiful selection of songs of thinking of God's forgiveness and grace. It goes so well with where we're going today in our second message in the series, Candid Conversations with God. I just want to say to those who are watching at home, and those who are here this morning, hello, I just want to say you are loved. It is so good. I was thinking about our church. I just want to say thank you for your flexibility as we go through this COVID season. And again, we're back to 10 being in the building next week, and which is basically your tech team and your worship team and the speaker. And so I know we'd all like to be here, and I know that we would all like to be able to come back. But this is where we are, and I just want to say thank you to our staff who has rolled with this so well, to our volunteers who serve on the worship team and greeting and tech teams and all of those things. Thank you so much for your time and being able to be here and to be able to serve. All throughout this season, we've had such a great host of people who have volunteered and served in so many different ways. And so I hope when you see some of them, I hope you just say thank you. You know, you're kind enough to send a card and things to us, and I never get tired of it. Thank you. It means a lot. But I hope maybe you'll kind of identify some people that are serving in different ways, and, you know, just send them a card or put something in the mail to them or drop it off here at church. We'll get it to them. But just to let them know how much we appreciate their service during this time as well. And then thank you. Thank you for being here. Thank you for praying. Thank you for your giving. Thank you for allowing us to be the church outside these four walls during this time. And I was just thinking about all of you today and just wanted to thank God for that. And as we go into these candid conversations with God, I don't know about you, but real life, real people conversations have my attention quite often. There's enough fluff that goes on in the world. There's enough surface stuff that happens at work or in other conversations. So when there's an honest, authentic conversation, it usually has our attention. And today we're looking at the Shepherd of Israel. We're looking at King David, who was a man after God's own heart, who was a man who wrote most of the Psalms, and was a guy that loved God passionately with his heart and served him. And yet he was a guy who made poor choices, wrong choices, choices that have cost others dearly, and they cost David and his family dearly. Now his private record, his private story, I should say, is really recorded over in 2 Samuel chapter 11. David is about 50 years of age at this time, and he's in the wrong place at the wrong time. It's springtime. This is when major campaigns are going on in different places, and he would be on the road with his army or with others, and touring the kingdom and doing those kind of things is what they do in the spring. But he stayed behind. We don't know why he stayed behind, but he did. And really, he was bound for trouble because he was the king, he was the psalmist, he loved God, but he put himself in a vulnerable position. In counseling, we call this HALT, H-A-L-T. And it stands, H is for hungry, A is for angry, L is for lonely, T is for tired. And so we as humans, we tend to make wrong or hurtful choices when we're hungry, when we're alone, when we're angry, and when we're lonely, and when we're tired. And no doubt David was tired and he was lonely. So on this particular day in 2 Samuel chapter 11, kingdom, his castle, his home overlooked the city, and he was looking down upon the city, and he sees Bathsheba. He sees Mrs. Uriah, who was taking a bath on the top of her roof patio. Now, that's not uncommon. That's where you bathe in those days, because you got the afternoon sun, they were able to warm water, and they were able to have a warm bath. And so that was not uncommon. And so as he was looking down, he sees this beautiful woman taking a bath. Instead of being a gentleman and looking away and saying, oops, and going to another room, he lets his imagination run wild. He sends for Bathsheba. They spend the evening together, and a couple of months later, she sends for David a note and says, I'm pregnant. David tries to cover his tracks. He tries to cover the sin of adultery. And so he brings Uriah home, who was in battle, was one of his soldiers, hoping that Uriah would go home to be with his wife, and then everybody would understand why she's pregnant. But Uriah would not go home. He didn't feel like he could go home. His band of brothers were on the battlefield. He didn't feel like that he could be there, enjoying the comforts of home while his comrades were in harm's way. And so, a second night goes by. David even gets him drunk, hoping that he'd go home. He didn't go home. And so the next day, Uriah carries a note from David to General Joab. Uriah is carrying a note that says, put Uriah in the heat of the battle so that he'll die. The guy was carrying his own death warrant. And so, sure enough, he was put into the heat of battle. Uriah was killed. David was as guilty as if he had shot the arrow. He marries Bathsheba. People thought it was a honeymoon baby. He got away with it, he thought. We pulled it off. My reputation's intact. Everything's okay. But there was a problem. The scripture says God was not pleased with David's actions. In fact, in the Lexham English Bible, it literally says, but the thing which David had done was evil in the eyes of Yahweh, God's name. David's pastor confronts David with his sin, and David admits it. God broke his heart. David confessed, and he repented. I want you to hear his repentance. I want us to think we're standing outside of the throne room, or maybe even outside of his bedroom, and I want you to I want you to hear King David talk to God in a candid conversation.
Have mercy on me, O God, because of your unfailing love. Because of your great compassion, blot out the stain of my sins. Wash me clean from my guilt. Purify me from my sin. For I recognize my rebellion. It haunts me day and night. Against you and you alone have I sinned. I have done what is evil in your sight. You will be proved right in what you say, and your judgment against me is just. For I was born a sinner, yes, from the moment my mother conceived me. But you desire honesty from the womb, teaching me wisdom even there. Purify me from my sins, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Oh, give me back my joy again. You have broken me. Now let me rejoice. Don't keep looking at my sins. Remove the stain of my guilt. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a loyal spirit within me. Do not banish me from your presence, and don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and make me willing to obey you. Then I will teach your ways to rebels, and they will return to you. Forgive me for shedding blood, O God, who saves. Then I will joyfully sing of your forgiveness. Unseal my lips, O Lord, that my mouth may praise you. You do not desire a sacrifice, or I would offer one. You do not want a burnt offering. The sacrifice that you desire is a broken spirit. You will not reject a broken and repentant heart, O God. Look with favor on Zion and help her. Rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. Then you will be pleased with sacrifices offered in the right spirit, with burnt offerings and whole burnt offerings. Then bulls will again be sacrificed on your altar.
Oh, man. David is having a very candid conversation with God. He had royally messed up. What's interesting, nobody was around to impress. Even Nathan, his pastor, was not there. Nobody was there to downplay the wrong that he had done, or nobody was there to help justify why it had happened and gone down the way it did. It was just David and God. And one of the most important subjects that we as followers of Christ need to learn from Jesus' teachings is the importance of repentance. This is something Jesus taught a lot on. And in fact, over in Luke chapter 18, he even gives just a very compelling story to illustrate a prideful heart and a repentant heart. And Jesus, in his teachings, he says, "The Pharisee stood by himself and prayed this prayer. I thank you, God, that I'm not like other people, cheaters and sinners and adulterers. I'm certainly not like that tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give you a tenth of my income." But the tax collector stood at a distance and dared not even lift his eyes to heaven as he prayed. Instead, he beat his chest in sorrow. "Oh God, be merciful to me, for I am a sinner." Jesus goes on to say, "I tell you, this sinner, not the Pharisee, returned home justified before God." See, one of the most important aspects in our daily journey as followers of God, as we journey with Him, is to be able to see life through His eyes, through His lens. Because repentance means literally to change direction. You're going this way, you repent. It's a change of mind, and then you go back the other way. It means to agree with God about us. That's what it means. So in David's life, God lovingly but firmly is dealing with David, bringing him to a place of reflection, a path to be able to be in sync with God once again. And so there's a couple of things that happens here. First, you'll notice in the psalm that there's confession to God. It's interesting here. Old Testament historians, they believe about a year went by before Nathan the prophet went before David to bring him to a place of admitting his guilt. Now, that's a long time to be trying to cover up something or to think maybe you've worked hard at keeping your path covered. Nobody knows the past. Nobody knows what has happened or been said or done. And you think about this. A year goes by before Nathan confronts David about his affair and subsequent murder of Uriah. What a spiritually dry year that must have been. For David to have gone through the motions, to have gone through just what everybody expected of him to do, because he was the king and he was the psalmist and his reputation of loving God. And you think about this, trying to live a normal life while looking over your shoulder. Who knows what's going on? Have I covered it? Has anybody found out? How exhausting to try and control the universe of who knows? Who's aware? Somebody once said, "We're only as sick as our secrets." And I think that is so true. And I think the Bible bears that out for us. But I love this about David. When he was confronted, it was almost a relief. There's this, in his conversation with God, he says, "Have mercy on me, O God. Because of your unfailing love, because of your great compassion, blot out the stain of my sins." You know what it means to blot? We've been in the process of getting ready to move, and we're downsizing to a smaller home, and so we were cleaning the carpets, and we have found some spots that Zena, our dog, has left surprises for us that we didn't know about. And so we've had to blot. We've had to get this special enzyme and blot. You know, not just rub, but really, that's what he's saying here. Lord, don't just cleanse, but blot. To really get in there and get rid of that stain in my life is what he was saying. I love that. Wash me, clean me from my guilt, purify me from my sin. He owns it. He did it. It wasn't Bathsheba's fault. It wasn't his genes. It wasn't his self-deception. It wasn't something that somebody talked him into doing. He owns his sin. And I admire that about him. I appreciate it. In fact, he says down in verse 3, there in Psalm 51, "For I recognize my rebellion." Get this. "It haunts me day and night." That word haunt, it means literally it's in front of me day and night. So he may have put on airs that everything was great. He may have gone through the motions that he was following God. He may have been doing all of that, but the fact was inside he knew that things weren't right. And he knew that things weren't right between he and God. And as he stared into the blackness of the ceiling at night, it haunted him. It was in front of him. He said, "Against you have I sinned. I've done what is evil in your sight. You'll be proved right in what you say. Your judgment against me is just." Here's a guy, it's like a floodgate opened, you know? He hid it for so long. He tried to keep the cards close to the vest. And when it opened, his heart completely opened and embraced what God was doing. This is ground zero for us as believers, because we don't always get it right. We don't always choose to do the right thing. We don't always have the right motives. We just sometimes don't get it right. And see, God wants us to have a tender heart about that. God wants us to have a heart that can be easily stirred by the working of the Holy Spirit. That is ground zero for us as believers. And this is how we become in sync with God once again. We agree with Him. We allow His Spirit to nudge us and to work in us in confession and acknowledging and owning and being responsible as one of His kids. There's a second thing. There's confession, but there's also, he was asking for a clearing with God. He says down in verse 7, "Purify me from my sins. I will be clean. Wash me, and I'll be whiter than snow." Here's a guy, David just wanted to feel clean again. He just wanted to have a clear account with God again. You know, purify me, clean me, let me be fresh again. I was fishing with my dad several years ago. My dad, they lived in Oklahoma City, and we'd go from Oklahoma City down to the Texas-Oklahoma border, and there's a huge lake system called Lake Texoma, some of the best striped bass fishing in the world. And my dad kept a boat down there, and it was an old cabin boat, and it was old. It was an old wooden boat, and normally you go to the marina and look in the boathouse, and it would be sitting low in the water. We named it the El Cinco, because every time we came, that boat was low in the water. You'd have to pump it out, and that thing would start every time, and it would work every time. And the water would stay out for a few days, and we were out fishing on Lake Texoma, and it was hot. It was in spring, and they go from winter to summer there. And so it was warm there. And it felt so good to be out fishing all day. And at the end of the first day, whew, kind of sweaty. Oh, and it's a good thing we're staying on the boat. And you wake up the next morning, it's kind of humid and you're kind of greasy, and you go fishing the second day and you're sweaty and your clothes are kind of damp, and by the time that third day comes, you're so nasty. You just feel nasty. And going home that night and getting under the hot shower with a bar of soap, you just feel so clean. You just feel so good. And that's what David was saying. I want to feel clean. I want to feel fresh. That was what he was expressing with God. And so he says, hey, I want you to clear this wayward heart of mine. Wipe it clean and fresh. And then he said the second thing. He said, would you restore joy to me? Would you restore joy? He says, oh, in verse 8, give me back my joy again. You've broken me. Now let me rejoice. Down in verse 12, restore to me the joy of my salvation. So let me ask you a question this morning. To you that are at home, to us here, let me just simply ask you, do you enjoy life? Do you enjoy life? Is there joy, maybe even some mirth in your life? Is there some gladness about you? Or has that been gone for a while? Well, I'm not talking about being life of the party. I've met people who are the life of the party, and sometimes they're some of the most miserable people, you know, when they're away from the crowd, when they're away from their friends, they just kind of melt. No, I'm just talking about as we go through life. Even in COVID, the question stands, do you love the Lord? Do you find joy in walking with Him, in following Him? Do you rest in knowing that even in this craziness of the season, that we're not perfect, but that we sense that we're in sync with God? Or is there a numbness? Is there maybe even a feeling of, I feel nothing. Oh, I have moments of laughter, or I have moments of this, or but overall, I'm just kind of numb. I just kind of feel myself feeling nothing. Now, please know, I'm not saying if joy's gone and emotionally you're suffering right now that you must be hiding huge sins. That's not what I'm saying. There can be environmental reasons. There can be physical reasons why you're feeling that way, emotional hurt, tough circumstances. But it is a good place to begin in assessing where we are with God. It's a good place to begin assessing the wellness of our spirit and of our soul. If we find ourselves emotionally and spiritually numb, that's a good place at least to explore in our life. Could it be that we may be finding ourselves trying to cover some wrong in our life? And in so doing, we lose joy in that journey. And so he says, oh God, that's what I did. Oh, would you please, I'm listening. You've broken my heart. I'm all yours. Would you let me rejoice again? I love that prayer, how honest and real it was. And I bet we've all been there at some point. There's a third thing. Not only clearing, but he says, I want joy restored. And the third thing, would you renew my spirit? I love how he says that. Create in me a clean heart, he's in verse 10. Oh God, renew a loyal spirit within me. The word renew is interesting. It literally means new moon. In other words, he was saying, Lord, can we start over again? Can we start fresh again? Can we wipe the slate clean and move forward? That's what he was saying. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew, new moon, new beginnings. It also means, the word also means repair. And he was saying, Lord, would you repair a loyal spirit in me? This guy's a king. He knows the importance of loyalty, right? And so he uses his word carefully as a king. How marvelously wise it was for him to pray that. Lord, create in me a clean heart. Renew, rebuild, refresh a loyal spirit within me. Because for the last year of David's life, he had not cared about those areas. He kind of avoided candid conversations with God. But here, nothing fake, nothing disingenuous. He's the real deal. Verse 11, do not banish me from your presence. Don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Lord, I strayed from you, but please do not stray from me. Isn't that beautiful? What he's asking, that's a heart in sync. And David talks about a heart that's in sync with God in another psalm. In Psalm 42, he says, as the deer longs for streams of water, so I long for you, O God. I thirst for God, the living God. And what David was saying is, Lord, I need you. I need you. Would you bow your head with me this morning? In light of what we're talking about, I'd like for us, whether you're at home, don't observe, participate with us, but let's all bow our heads for just a moment. You have a piece of paper and a pencil, and we'd like to walk through a prayer exercise as we kind of conclude this morning, and Cook, our worship leader, is going to kind of walk us through this exercise.
I invite you now to grab a little piece of paper and something to write with as we make space now for some self-examination and for confession. Let's pray now to El Roy, the God who sees me. Lord, we come to you now in a world where parts of ourselves are seen all the time through social media. Lord, we acknowledge that you are the only one who truly sees us. We just sit under your eye, realizing that you know every corner of our heart and soul intimately. God, we want to take a moment to choose to reveal to you our true selves. So friends, I encourage you to write something down that you have never told anyone else, or something that you have been intentionally trying to hide from God. It could be something positive. It could be a deep desire and longing for something that you have been suppressing or squashing down. Or it could be a secret sin, a negative emotion, a resentment that has been festering. Write it down and give it to God.
What's that?
I invite you to repeat after me. God, I invite you into this. I open my soul to you. I want to be fully known. I give you this hidden part of myself. And I want you to feel the Father's gaze, his loving eyes, as he says, "My child, I already knew. Let's pray through David's words, knowing that these things are already so, and asking him for his provision. God, I thank you for your mercy, for your unfailing love. I thank you that you are constantly creating a clean heart in me. I thank you that you have the power to restore my spirit and to renew it. I praise you that you will never cast me away from your presence, and I ask that you would make me more aware of your presence before me and behind me, beside me, all around me, and within me. I thank you that you will never take your Holy Spirit, my Comforter, away from me. I thank you that you restore my joy. I accept your joy and claim it as my strength. I thank you for your mercy and for your unfailing love. Help me to find my rest in you. Amen.
Thank you.
So as we go home today and as we face the week ahead of us, I pray that this candid conversation, I pray, will be a great help to each of us in just helping us in our daily life of being in sync with God. Oh, I think it's wonderful. Not what David did, but how David responded. As we open our hearts as well for God to be able to do his work in us. Maybe it wasn't pleasant for David. He surely seems to say that. We see that in Psalm 32 last week. But he also gives great rejoicing and thanksgiving for the experience of it. And so may God bless us this week. May it help keep our hearts sensitive and tender as he guides us in conversations, or he guides us in our workings with people and as we do business and as we live our lives. May people see Christ in us. I pray that you have a great week. I'm going to pray and then we'll dismiss from the back. You may leave first and then corresponding up to the front. May God bless you. May you have a great week. And join us for Sunday school on Zoom. You can join us right away from home, or if you get home in time, we'd love for you to join us as well. Jesus, we love you. We thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity to worship you. And Lord, we thank you that we can be on a journey with you, to be in sync with you. Lord, thank you for helping us to be able to do that by your Holy Spirit. Lord, this is something that by your Spirit we're able to do this, and we give you the glory for that. Thank you for this day. Thank you for the worship of this morning. Thank you for the fellowship of God's people. Lord, thank you for the technology to be together, though we're all separate. We thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. You are loved. Folks at home, you are loved. Have a great week.